Welcome to the second part of my journey around Sicily, the southernmost region of Italy. I'm David Celdran, and I'm joining Trafalgar Scholars of Sicily tour, which circles the island's coast, from the historic capital Palermo in the north to the fertile farmlands of Marsala in the western seaboard, and onwards along the Mediterranean shoreline to the Acropolis of Agrigento and the Baroque hill towns of the Val di Noto, before ending this voyage in the ancient seaports of Siracusa and Taormina. Along the journey, I'll sample the island's legendary cuisine, visit its several World Heritage sites, revel in its elegant architectural legacy, and bask in its mythical natural scenery. It's time to say arrivederci to the multicultural splendors of Palermo and continue the journey to the southern coastline of Sicily, where during ancient times, some of the Mediterranean's richest cities used to exist. We're on our way up to Erice, one of Sicily's loveliest villages and one of its highest, at 2,500 feet above the sea.
I know. Sicily is known for its coastline, its beaches. So what are we doing up above the clouds? Well, here's one thing. I know a lot of people come to Sicily and stay by the coastline. It makes a lot of sense because that's where some of the most famous cities are. However, Sicily is also an extremely mountainous region. So if you want to get a different taste, get a different feel of a different side of the region, you might want to climb up a mountain like Mount Erice. And you'll be surprised what you'll find there.
Like the rest of Sicily, this ancient town mentioned in Virgil's Aeneid mirrors the layers of civilizations that settled here and found refuge within the walls of this well-protected citadel. Once a strategic fortress overlooking the coast, today Erice's cool mountain climate and fabulous bird's eye views are better known for hiking trips and picnics.
If you've seen pictures of Erice, it's probably nothing like this, right? Usually it's sunny, they show a view of the valley, the seaside. But this is rather interesting, a different way of seeing the city.
This is Erice without the mist. And this is Erice now, shrouded in it. Indeed, it's a bit strange to see people in winter gear at the start of summer here. And since you can't enjoy the sunny scenery, you might as well experience Erice differently.
You see, in our age of Instagram, everyone flocks to the same place to get that perfect scenic shot. But if you just forget about that mindset of looking for perfect shots, you can really appreciate a town or a city that's shrouded in mist, and use your imagination. Imagine what it was like to live here in this isolated mountaintop in the 1500s, for example, or even way before that, when Erice was founded.
Yes, perhaps way, way back when the Carthaginians first landed here, or before the Greeks, the Arabs, the Normans, and a string of European kingdoms left their mark on its skyline and streets.
Yes, here we are, the castle. Now, this is one thing where you don't really require a lot of sunlight. In fact, this mist, this fog, gives this ancient castle a bit more drama, right?
The Norman-era Castello di Venere, the Castle of Venus, was built using materials from an old temple of Venus nearby. No one here still worships the goddess of love and beauty, but locals have turned the castle grounds and surrounding gardens into Erice's most romantic strip. I must say, despite or perhaps because of the mist, Erice feels so charming and sweet. Even the air has that sugary quality, literally, because the town is known for having some of Sicily's most famous pastry shops and bakeries.
What's the fuss about? What's that long line all about? Well, it's about this one. Now, if you're familiar with the book, Bitter Almonds, well, probably half the people who are lining up there are there because they want to try a particular pastry, the one I got.
In a region known across Italy for having the best sweets, it takes a lot to stand out the way the Pasticceria Maria Grammatico has. No doubt the best-selling book on the bittersweet story of its founder, Maria, which features the old recipe she learned from nuns in a convent here, have helped gain fame for it. But more so the taste of the pastry she still makes in the kitchen, even at her old age.
Yes, this is Maria herself, the legend behind this beautiful story. And say hello. Ciao. Brava, Maria, brava.
There are dozens of dolci to choose from colorful marzipan sweets to traditional Sicilian cakes and almond cookies. But you must try her famous cream-filled Genovese arancina pastries. Indeed, even if the weather turns for the worse, the delicious delicacies you come across in the streets more than makes up for it. Arancini, deep-fried risotto balls, may be the most common and affordable meal in Sicily. But these ones made by a celebrity chef on site are on a different level of freshness and quality with a choice of premium ingredients for the filling.
Mm. That mushroom is really savory. And generous too. All right, now let's try a more traditional arancini or arancino recipe. Al ragù, that's red meat sauce, of course. This ground beef, tomato sauce, and a saffron rice.
As it turns out, heading up here in the rain wasn't so foolish. But with the clouds getting heavier, it's time to move to drier land closer to the sea, to Marsala, in the westernmost province of Trapani.
So this is the city of Marsala, and for foreigners like me, we probably associate this city more with the world-famous fortified wine, Marsala wine from this city. For Italians, however, this city is better known for dramatic events that occurred here. The landing of Giuseppe Garibaldi on May 11, 1860, taking Sicily for the newly unified Italian crown.
Marsala, which comes from the Arabic Marsala, God's Harbor, was known throughout its history for the seaport here. It was where foreign invaders landed over the centuries, including Giuseppe Garibaldi's legendary Expedition of 1,000. Volunteers from northern Italy, who many Sicilians still consider an invading army. I won't get into Italian politics here, but I suggest reading up on events after 1860, when Sicilians were made to think of themselves as Italians for the first time in their history. Locals are still divided about unification, and Marsala has become the symbol of a problematic identity, one that was previously defined by centuries of Spanish rule and seen in the Baroque cityscape they left behind after Garibaldi's troops defeated the Bourbon army.
It's a beautiful afternoon, and it's a beautiful spot here in the historic center of Marsala. It's a Piazza della Repubblica, it's the main square, and just like most main squares in Italy, you'll find the cathedral, government buildings, some of the best coffee shops. Of course, everything looks like it's in its original Baroque state. The truth is, a lot of these are really restored because Marsala was heavily bombed in World War II by the Allies.
The historic center is small enough you can explore the elegant streets of town in just a couple of hours, with enough time and sun left in the day to explore Marsala's equally picturesque shoreline. In a Trafalgar tour, you get much more than just these views of the sea. You get a deep dive into the local culture and help preserve traditions that are slowly disappearing, like the ancient craft of salt making. A guided tour of the Ettore in Inversa salt works, one of the last of its kind where sea salt is still manually harvested, takes you back to the time when the Phoenicians who settled here established salt pans like those over two millennia ago.
Fascinating how salt still made the ancient way and still done primarily by hand here in these salt flats or salt beds in this side of Marsala. You see, today you can buy salt pretty much anywhere, any neighborhood store. But back in the day, in the ancient times, salt was an extremely precious ingredient. In fact, that's how the Roman soldiers were paid, with salt. Thus, the word salary, sale, the Italian word for salt.
Even the old windmills, which used wind to power the millstones to grind salt, were restored in order to recreate the traditional process.
So, if you want to get a better sense of how salt is made the ancient way, and pretty much the same way it's still made today, this, above the windmill, is where you get a sense of how that process happens. It begins in the open sea, and step by step along the way, through these different levels of salt beds.
Wind, sun, seawater, plus ingenuity and manual labor. These are still the only ingredients to produce the world-famous natural sea salt from Marsala and Trapani. Products used by Italy's best chefs and producers of prosciutto and Parmigiano-Reggiano cheese. Artisanal salt and lovely sea views, however, aren't the only things Marsala is famous for.
Of course, no trip to Marsala is ever complete without Marsala, the fortified wine, of course. Let's do some wine tasting tonight.
Sicily is home to some of Italy's best loved and best value wines. But for the rest of the world, perhaps only the local Marsala wine rings a bell. The optional tour at the historic Pellegrino Winery shows you that even if Marsala is Sicily's most popular export, it's only one of dozens of wine varieties produced in a part of the island that's been making wine since the Phoenicians planted vines here. But like sherry from Spain and port from Portugal, Marsala of Sicily owes its global fame and distinct Swedish nutty taste to English merchants who fortified the local wine to keep it from spoiling during the long sea journey to England, where the product is still most popular today.
I can smell it already. We're getting closer to the wine tasting. But first, you have to understand the different regulations that control the process of making Marsala.
Tasted a lot of wine, even fortified wine. But this is my first time to try Marsala, a blend of local grape varietals fortified with grape spirit and produced in three different colors and levels of sweetness and aged in a varying number of years in oak barrels. The highest quality is made and aged using the Solera system, not unlike sherry from Spain.
So this is 9 years.
9 years, yeah. All the 9 years can be smell.
A musty smell.
Yeah, because you have what we call a really, really complex wine, okay? Because we have a lot of different hints that belongs to different families. The most important one is the ethereal hints. It means that you're going to smell all the toast from the oak. Barrel from the oak, yeah. And a sort of wax, like for example, all the dry fruits, the licorice, for example, yeah.
Of course, they offer more than just a single glass of wine. At the tasting room of the Pellegrino Winery, our hosts prepared a number of other wines to enjoy with Sicilian specialties, like their Gibelle, made with a native Zibibbo grape.
A truly aromatic wine. I think the best way to describe this would be like walking into a Sicilian fruit market, or maybe a Mediterranean garden.
And their Passito, made as well with Zibibbo grapes, but left to raisin under the scorching August sun to bring out a subtle sweetness that's perfect with dessert.
Wow, that's really good. Wow.
Once more, aged Marsala, this time poured onto fresh strawberries for a refreshing, sweet and tarty twist on the palate. As they say, what grows together, goes together. Sicilian wine and Sicilian food. It's a match made in paradise.